With all the success that you guys have had, there's only one of us in this room right now who's wearing two wristwatches. Why? Because he can. I guess he's got all the extra money. Might as well. Now, Spencer, what's the name? Are you just trying to show us up with an extra wristwatch or what?
No, I'm not. I'm not trying to show anybody up.
I'm serious. I'm going to pass the man that hat for you.
What's the deal on that?
That's a sobering thought. I mean, I don't know if that's the kind of story to start this off with, but I shared this with Coach Switzer, and I've since shared it with Keith a while back in an event that he had me come speak to in April. And I don't know if you remember, Coach, but this was in Dallas. You were still with the Cowboys at the time. And I had an experience where I was sitting in the Marriott Hotel lobby watching, it was New Year's Eve, getting ready to do one of the games. I can't remember if it was Northwestern, Tennessee, Florida Citrus Bowl, and Kenny Smith, who is the TNT guy, one of your cohorts now, even though in a different sport, walks up behind me and slaps me on the back of the neck and says, "What are you doing?" And I was just sitting there by myself, just watching it. It's about 11:58. Dick Clark was doing his deal with the bulb, everything coming down, and I looked up there and I said, "That's interesting." It reminded me of something. This is a quote by Soren Kierkegaard, and he said that all of us must make noise on New Year's Eve to drown out the macabre sound of grass growing over our graves. It was better when we had hourglasses. The clocks deceive us, but we had to invent them, but we needed the deception. For the rotating hands give us the illusion that time goes on forever. And meanwhile, we curse the hourglass because indeed it's a constant reminder that time is truly running out. And so one of these watches doesn't work. It stopped. Time run out. It's just a constant reminder that when we come together like this, these are rare moments. You got to bring it all in, suck it all in, never let it go. So that's why I wear two watches.
That's a great story.
I'm not a pimp or nothing.
What do you think, Bob? Since we're taping this on Sunday, should we sit back now for the gospel according to Barry?
Right, exactly. And,
Coach Switzer?
Hey, I was just trying to reflect on the silver shoes. I'd forgotten about that. You know, when we recruited a little Joe out of Port Arthur, Texas, that I was told that the guy had a bag of shoes he carried with him. Most of them were silver. And whatever school he went to, that he was going to have to play with those silver shoes. Well, I'd already heard Daryl said, "Hell, he's going to wear what we wear." And I heard that they said that up in Colorado and wherever else. And I said, "I hadn't seen tape the guy yet." Well, I looked at the film of the guy, and I said, "I don't care if someone's played barefoot or something." Just give him the ball.
It did have a lot to do with my coming to Oklahoma, being able to wear silver shoes, because at that time, we're talking in the early 70s, everybody wore black shoes. And, you know, you may have a few, you know, players, you know, wide receivers, quarterbacks or whatever, you know, they might spat their shoes or they may wear white shoes. But at Oklahoma, everybody wore white shoes. Linemen, the coaches, I mean, I say,
You're all in styling.
Huh? Oh, absolutely. Hey, I knew if nothing else, I was going to get to wear 24, going to play with the same backfield with Greg Pruitt, and get to wear silver shoes. So I say, life is good. Can't get any better than that.
As we play in Southern Cal, with Sam Bam Cunningham, John McKay, and that crew, we're playing. Lynn Swann was a sophomore. We're playing them in Norman, 1971. And we hang about 38, 35 points on Southern Cal, and we've rushed for over 500 yards, and we're 0-0 in passing. Milton, in the fourth quarter, we come out of the damn game, and Milton says, "Lace, let's throw one." I said, "Okay." We throw the son of a bitch, and it's incomplete. And I said, "See there? We get made 8 more yards. We had 8 more yard rushing yards ahead, Jack. Pruitt was averaging 9.4 a carry, and he wants to throw football."
In the USC game, I had a jersey, and the hello goodbye, it really came from Coach Switzer. And Coach Switzer said, "I got this shirt I want you to wear." And I liked it, hello, goodbye. And he said, "Well, put
come
it on
the front, goodbye on the
he
back."
Said, "Well, put it, he said, "Well, put it on and, you know, go to class." You know, so I'm on my way to class, and reporters find me, and they start taking pictures of me, and I'm like, I'm enjoying all of it.
So when I get back to
practice, Coach Switzer say, "Now, you know by now that picture's in the USC locker room, so it better be hello, goodbye, Saturday."
Yeah.
Just looking around, they got great football players in here, two broadcasters, and Uwe. I'm so proud
to be among football players because I never played football. Okay, but I did score all the points.
Every team needs a kicker. We all have to have a kicker.
How you doing back there in the cheap seats?
I'm just taking it all in. It's just so much fun. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Hey, Uwe, tell them about what you told me when you had a couple pops one night, and you were telling me about that play up September the 24th, 1977, in Columbus, Ohio. If you want, I want you to tell them what you said to me, then I'll tell them what I said to you. Go ahead and tell me. We had a couple of pops, and then what'd you say?
I don't know if I remember.
No, yeah, you did. That was before you had too many pops.
No, I say.
But what you said to me, he says, Coach, is one of the biggest plays, excuse me, take a drink, was that September 24th, the kick to beat Ohio State at Columbus, 1977. He says, that had to be one of the biggest plays in your career, and for me, the biggest one. And I, you know what my response, Eddie? What my response was, Keith, I looked back at Uwe, and I said, Uwe, I want to tell you something about that. And I said, you know, if Thomas Lott hadn't pulled his hamstring in the first quarter and Billy Sims hadn't injured his ankle in the first quarter, and so we'd hung half an under in their ass just like we do everybody else, we wouldn't need your damn field goal.
But what do I see when I, during the timeout, what do I see? He's on his knees, right? He's on his knees. Well, okay, Coach.
We need you when we needed you. That's what I meant. We need you when we needed you. But really, we got him 22-0 in the first quarter. Thomas re-injures his hamstring. Billy goes out of the ball game, and we turned the ball over, about 8 times in a row, and we let him back in it, and we needed you.
41-yard field goal to win it. It is long enough. It is good. Wow. With 3 seconds to play in the game, the Oklahoma team and some of their fans have come onto the field in exultation as Von Scammon hit it on the money. Just a few yards away from this exultation, Ohio State players still lying prostrate on the field, pounding the turf in frustration.
So that's how it works. But, you always got to have a kicker there to save it.
That's why you recruited him.
When I talk to some of the Sooner fans and they bring up the game, they always tell me some great stories. But the best story I was told by one of our coaches. He told his girlfriend before we went to Columbus that if we win the game, that he was going to marry her. Well, about 5 years later, I saw him, and he said, I sure wished you would have missed that summer.
That was one of the biggest plays in Oklahoma football.
Well,
No question about it.
No, Uwe was wanting to brag about it. I want to put it in place in good fun.
It was, really. Yeah.
But I promise you this, if Thomas doesn't re-injure his hamstring and Billy doesn't go out of the game, we're going to hang half a hundred on him.
And I look around, I see George Cumbie here, and I think about great linebackers. Yeah. And Tubbs and Bob Harrison was one of the best of all time. But we might have to call it linebacker U2, man, I tell you.
Yeah, well, I know, you really can't talk about, Oklahoma and Lyman and not mention, Lucius, Leroy and Dewey, of course. And I think those are probably, during, our era, the, guys that could probably play both ways. And I don't mean they'd probably end up playing line. You could probably put them in the backfield in some cases. Because, I thought they were just that good, especially Leroy. The whole 4 years there, I don't know if I ever saw him block one time.
Now, Leroy was a tailback in high school, wasn't he?
Well, they all played back. Lucius was the tailback, Leroy was the tailback, and Dewey was a fullback. So all three of them played for the Ironheads. You followed them. They were all backs. Obviously, they were going to be backs for us. They all thought they were. Lucius thought he was going to be the next Jim Brown. But we knew we were going to squat him down on the ground. But talk about George Cumbie, great linebackers. You mentioned that. George and I were talking about this at lunch today. I was sitting beside Brian, and I said, here are two great linebackers that played at Oklahoma in our era. I says, but George, I had to beat Henderson Junior College in Athens, Texas, to get him, because he was at P.K. Gorman High School across town in Tyler, Texas, away from John Tyler and all the other 4 or 5A high schools. He's over at this parochial school from LaRue, Texas, a little crossroad community. And I find out about him, and I go over and get some film, and I take it back and said, Lacewell, look at this kid. We hear he's a pretty good linebacker. Well, Lacewell goes back there, and he said, comes to my office a few minutes later. So you need to come look at this film. Everybody across town recruiting Earl Campbell. And we go back there and sit down, and we look at this film. This kid makes every tackle, sideline to sideline, every play, then runs the ball and scores every play. So I said, let's offer this kid, bring him in to visit. We bring him in and offer him a scholarship. Well, I got assigned Kenny King. This Billy Sims. We had a great recruiting year that year. I got Billy Sims out here in Hooks, Texas. I got Clarendon, Texas, Kenny King over, Greg Roberts, the Tabor Twins over here, Thomas Lott down here at San Antonio. And I got to fly around and get all these kids. But Billy's going to want me to sign him at 8 o'clock. Kenny King's going to want me to sign him at 8 o'clock. You've been on that switch before. And I said, Billy, I got an idea here. Billy says, why don't you hide out for a couple of days, see? Let all the dust clear and all these guys get signed. Then you get all the attention. The headlines will be on you. Where's Billy? He buys this. See, boy, that sounds like a good idea. So you're going to get all the headlines. So I go to Clarendon, Texas. I get to sign Kenny King, see? So I'm with Kenny that night, some pool hall in Clarendon, Texas. He got his girlfriend. We check into a motel. I got connecting rooms. I'm with Eddie Kenny that's a recruit. That's his recruit. But anyway, the next day I fly to Tyler, Texas, and George's grandmama, bless her heart, his granddaddy, it's who he lived with. They're sitting there at a little table in the Tyler Airport, and I land there, and we taxi up, and I get out my papers and run up there and set down Steve, and I'm going to sign George Cumbie. Nobody's recruiting. North Texas State, who was it? Howard Payne, and University of Oklahoma. He's scared to death. And he says, Coach, I think I'm just going to go to Henderson Junior College. I said, you're not coming to the University of Oklahoma? I said, George, I don't care if Texas A&M, those guys aren't recruiting you. You can play. Trust me, you're a great player. Well, anyway, I overcome Henderson County Junior College, and we sign it, and he comes to Oklahoma, and obviously he was 3-time All-American at our place, great player, and you never know where they come from.
Yeah, I remember you told me that if I went anywhere else, no matter where I went, if Oklahoma played you, we were going to beat you. I said, you might well come to Oklahoma.
Necessarily in that tone of voice.
Yeah.
What did you think you were going to play when you showed up at Oklahoma?
Well, I came in and we were a running back coming out of Eufaula, Oklahoma. And in my opinion, I thought I was pretty good. Here I am, a fullback, I'm a blocking back for Leroy. He was trying to run up my tail end all night long. And we get there, you know, and he's there, you know, his first year there and coming in. And first day of practice and stuff, we thought was pretty fast, too. You know, we chase through pigs around and catch them all day long. And then I saw this guy walking around with these silver shoes on. And he's out there. He's making moves at top speed like we'd never seen before. Me and Leroy looked at this very, very quickly. We deduced, I don't think we're going to be running backs anymore.
I tell you what, though, I had to play linebacker in the All-State game against Leroy and Dewey at fullback and tailback. You don't think that wasn't ridiculous? And I'm glad they went to Oklahoma because I got real lucky. Everybody ran away from him, and I got to make plays and be All-American.
It was great. It was a great time to be a Sooner, and I think it's been a great time in the 50s to be a Sooner. And for me, you know, it's great because when I was being recruited by Chuck Fairbanks, who was the last season there before Coach Woods came on, who was assistant there at the time, at the same time, Coach Eddie Crowder came down from Colorado recruiting me and Lear at the same time, and it was a tough choice for us to decide on which school was going to. Lucia was already there at Oklahoma University, but the main thing that made it a tough choice was the quality of the coaches who came to see us. What they did represent, we talk about Bud Wilkinson and the aura he had about him. I tell you what, when you have a guy recruiting like Coach Switzer, Coach Crowder, when they come to your house, your mom and dad, who's not been around football, but they are also impressed with the quality of these two men. That speaks a lot for what Oklahoma University has to offer any athlete at during any time. And my own opinion and stuff, I really think that we as a group, and it may go back to Bud, to Cross, something was started, something good. And I think what's so great about the Selman family is that, not that we're good, so great ourselves, is the fact that we had the opportunity to be a part of something that was already good. That we will die one day, and I think as humans, we like to be said of ourselves that we are associated with someone or something. And to be associated with Oklahoma University is one of those good things. Maybe we'll say one better not to be associated with Jesus Christ himself, a great thing. But I tell you what, to sit in the same room with a bunch of guys like this, irresponsible of age, race, time we played, position, it feels good. And I think that's what that word OU stand for. If you're there, you feel good at all times.
Keith, I see Keith just nodding away in agreement.
Well, let me tell you, that this makes me want to cry because you know what? You know, when you hear me talk about the Selmans, and the players I know because I know them, because I've lived with them and understand them, it's when I get to have you hear what they are. Not just a nose guard and a tackle, two tackles, and a family from Eufaula, Oklahoma. You get to see the depth of what we mean and what we talk about when you say, God bless Miss Selman. You know what I mean? Yeah. Because you've never heard Selman, Dewey, or any of the Selmans articulate themselves, have you? Have you? Really? Bill, you haven't?
I've been privileged to hear your brother.
Most of you had. And that's what, Jerry, you hadn't had.
Absolutely.
Is that impressive?
Absolutely.
See, that's what I mean. That's good stuff, Dewey.
You got to tell the recruiting story, pay. Coach.
What's that?
You got to tell them how you recruited Lucius. You just said, go ahead and sign him. Remember you say about his height?
Well, yeah. Well, I'll tell you, I told, what was it? I forgot who
was
I was.
Proctor? Was it Proctor?
Yeah, someone said, if he's tall as you are, go ahead and sign him. And yeah, it was a different deal, but after I saw those two young guys, those two young pups come in, I said, my gosh, that's his brothers? We knew we didn't want to miss on those two, Leroy and Dewey. But yeah, I remember Keith Jackson. You know, Keith Jackson was everything coming out of Parkview High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. Great, great high school football player. Could have gone anywhere in the world coming out of high school. Comes to Wishbone School in Oklahoma. That was, maybe a big mistake for him, but great for Oklahoma football. But I'll never forget the day he comes in my office, just like
you did
quarterbacks.
Though,
yeah,
you did
how allowed you come in there and sit down with me. It's like he's quarterback. They want to throw the ball. He says, Coach, I need the ball in my hands. I need the ball in my hands. I said, y'all don't throw the ball enough for me. Hand me the ball. You know what happens that day? I leave that office, don't I? Yep. I said, come with me. I walked down to the offensive coordinator's room. I walked in there, didn't I?
Yep.
I had my arm on him. Walk in there, and I tell that offensive staff, hold on, turn off the projector. And say, we got a great football player here. I believe he can make plays and win ball games. I said, I want you to get the damn ball in his hands. I don't care how you do it. Get the ball in his hands. Are you happy?
Just don't throw it to him.
No, I didn't say just don't throw it to him. I turned around, boys. I turned around. Hey, that's why I turned around. I said, you happy now, Keith? And he said, yes, sir. I said, as long as they get the ball in my hand. You know, we put the tight end reverse in that day in practice. Went out, worked on the tight end reverse that day. Comes to Nebraska ball game, and we're standing on the sidelines in 1985. And we just put it in that week. And Bobby Bell, my hunting fishing coach, stand beside me. And first third down of the ball game, third play of the game, we're 88 yards from the goal. And Donna says, let's run that, let's put the ball in Keith's hands and see if he can make a big play for it. And Bobby Bell says, what are you calling here? And I said, we're going to score a touchdown. And that's exactly what I said to him. Hell, I don't know where we're just going to get the ball in his hands. He runs 88 yards for a touchdown. I said, I get on the phone and said, we need to run. Why didn't we put that damn play in sooner? Keith, then I said, Keith, why didn't you come see me sooner? Let's put a lot more in your hands.
I tell you what, you know, you talk about great coaches, and Coach Switzer is definitely one of the greatest in my thoughts. But when we were talking earlier today, myself and Jerry Tubbs, we were talking about Bud Wilkinson, and I didn't know Coach Wilkinson at all. And we were talking about, he asked me what type of coach did I like. And I said, well, I played for some, but I really like those West Coast offense coaches. You know, the West Coast coaches are really understanding. They don't scream and holler at you. I said, they brought this new style of coaching to the game where it's more education and everything. And he goes, that was Bud Wilkinson. I said, wow, I thought I was creating something new. And Bud, like, oh, yeah, this West Coast, you know, all those guys in San Francisco, everybody from that. He goes, that's exactly how Bud Wilkinson was. He was before his time. During a time in the era when coaches would beat you up, you know, the Junction Boys and all that, during that time, here's a coach as we're understanding and really just embraced his players, and his players respect them so much. And that was a great time. I mean, that was a great conversation we had. But when you go back to Coach Switzer, you can't argue there can't be a better recruiter anywhere in the country. Nowhere in the country. There can't be a better recruiter. I can remember he walks into my house in Little Rock, Arkansas, and he comes in, this big visit. I didn't know I was that good of a player, but he comes in and walks in, and he sits down at the on the couch, and he has his little loafers on, and he kicks his shoes off just a little bit and takes his shoes off inside the house. And my mother kind of looked at him a little funny, like, this white man is taking his shoes off in my house. So old Coach Switzer puts that old charm on her, you know, at that time. He goes, Gladys, let me ask you a question. And I'm sitting up here thinking I'm finna hear some really good football stuff from this great coach I watched on TV. And he said, now, do you just cook regular cornbread or do you make hot water cornbread?
And she, I ordered a recipe for crackling bread.
Yeah, crackling bread.
The crackling bread recipe.
You got a recipe for crackling bread, and you make hot water cornbread. And then he goes from there to collard greens and beans and everything. They sit in there for about 2 hours talking about food. From Crossett, Arkansas, she's from Sherrill, Arkansas, a little country folk. And they talk about food, and he walks out the door, never says a thing about football. Not one word about football. And he turns around, I mean, just great, make a great movie. And he says, if he comes to Oklahoma, I'll take care of him. And he walks out the door. My mother is a solid 100% Razorback fan. She said, if you're not going to Arkansas, that's your only other choice.
So that's part of Coach's 10-minute rule. His 10-minute rule is, if I can be in a recruit's house and in 10 minutes feel comfortable enough to take my shoes off, he's coming to Oklahoma.
You got to recruit the feet.
Yeah, you
got to recruit the parents, though, don't you?
Yeah, I want to hear really Keith. I know we're probably winding up, but I want to hear Keith tell a story about the one time you did. You talked about going to him to get a play or something. One time you were a little bit disgruntled and thought, not necessarily you, in an unselfish act, you go on behalf of another talented guy from Arkansas, Eric Mitchell, to plead your case. And you came to me for advice.
Yeah, I did.
On what you think you should do.
You know, Switzer's always been approachable. You know, Coach Switzer's always been approachable. You can always walk in his office and you can talk to him. And so I went to Spencer. I said, I'm having a little trouble. We got Jamel Holloway playing quarterback, and I helped recruit Eric Mitchell to come over here. And Eric runs a 4.3. Jamel runs a 4.7. You know, Eric can bench press the world. Jamel doesn't go to the weight room. You know, just athletically, they're just two different type of athletes. And I said, what should I do? Spencer said, well, you just need to go talk to Coach. He'll listen to you. So I walked in the door. I didn't know he had that little switch on his desk that closed the door. I said, Coach, I'm coming here to talk to you about some serious stuff now. I'm on behalf of Eric Mitchell. And so Coach hits that button, and that door closes. I go, oh, God, what have I done? And so we sit down, and I learned a lot from Coach Switzer. And we sit down, and he really didn't stop. At that point, he went and got some film clip, and he showed me film clip. Clem, I don't know if you remember this, Coach, you said, look at Jamel Holloway and look at the plays. What are we running? We're running 19-9 or whatever the play was, going to the left or going to the right. He said, Jamel Holloway runs those plays to perfection. Now, watch Eric. I said, look at that. He ran 80 yards for a touchdown. He said, yeah, he sure did. Watch this play. He ran 70 yards for a touchdown. He looked at all the athletic ability. He said, yeah, both of those plays, he went the wrong way. And this is exactly what he said. He said,
that's too short.
He said that he went the wrong way. I said, well, he still has more athletic ability. He said, Keith Jackson, we don't play to beat Iowa State, Kansas, or Kansas State. We play to beat Nebraska. They got Neil Smith, Broderick Thomas. He started naming all names. He said, you go the wrong way against them, you make a bad decision, you don't win that football game. And so that was the coach he was. I mean, here's a guy who clearly had more athletic ability, but then here's a guy who was a scientist in a sense at that quarterback position and made the right decisions. Maybe not as gifted as an athlete, but definitely a playmaker and won several great games for us.
That happens kind of every program in America, though. It happens every program in America.
You those are the kind of stories that get me excited because, you know, when you have a guy that comes in and I remember when Troy Aikman broke his leg against Miami.
I cried that day.
Did you cry that day? Because you know you were going to get the ball passed to you.
No more passes. Yeah, he would have been 3 years of passing.
That's true. He sure would have. But when he broke his tibia or whatever it was in his ankle or leg.
Jerome Brown, Miami.
Jamel came in, and I think Jamel would just turn. He wasn't even 18 at the time. He was 17. And I remember him coming in the huddle, and he looked, and he said, you know, I'm short. He's shorter than I am. And he says, let's roll. And I look at Lydell and a couple other guys and we're like, what's this fool talking about? Let's roll. And I'll be darned. You know, we lost that game, but we didn't lose another. We won a national championship that year. But I think what he was able to exude and talking to Jamel, he came in with a certain amount of confidence. But I think confidence is contagious. Merv touched on it a little bit. When Coach says what he says, it's because he will say what is important and what is the right thing. Most people won't deal with reality. They'll deal with what they believe you want to hear. I remember one time I came in the weight room and Coach came in with a nice pair of alligator boots on. You know, Coach got that little walk, right? He comes in there and he's...
And I said, that's some nice shoes, so you don't have to work for them, son of a bitch. You know, that's what probably a kid like that needed to hear. You know, we needed to hear the truth as opposed to some flashy guy come telling us we're going to have anything we wanted to hear. And it's a different technique than maybe Bud Wilkerson would have, but I think at the end of the day, the same thing is accomplished. You know, you get a sense that you're going to have to work for this. You're not going to get anything free.
And how about yourself? Yeah. How about you, we haven't heard your recruiting story.
My recruiting story? Yeah. Well, you know, I came out of, you know, not a very good high school, at least success-wise. And, you know, I don't know about a lot of you other players, but, you know, I had kind of a self-esteem problem. I mean, I felt that was a very,
very... There he was there.
This guy in 1984 was Dennis Rodman before Dennis Rodman ever thought about it.
There was a seed that got planted and then that got watered, and I think it, you know, it's probably the fault of the man sitting next to me. And you know, my father was really hard on me, and you did a good job of winning my father over. And when I grew up, I was a redneck. I was born in Oklahoma, and then I got transplanted to Texas, and I got fortunate enough that I got to go back and spend some time with my grandfather on his farm in Little Meeker, Oklahoma. You know, my granddad, I just looked up to him. He was like God to me. I just said, you know, I just want to do, you know, whatever I can to please my grandfather. And you know, when I got a chance to go up there when I was a kid, he'd work me like a slave. I mean, I'd go out and pick the corn, I'd get the green beans, I'd bring the cows in for milk, I'd
no
go get
shit,
the eggs.
Man, you know what we feel like. hey, dude, he like way up them hogs in there.
Yeah, got a chance.
Okay, come on, fish story now. We got to hear this.
Well, you know, I got paid, though. You know, I get paid, you know, a sick pack of Coke. And, you know, and he would grant me the privilege of going home and getting him a stag beer. And I would run back as fast as I could, and I'd hand it to him, and he smoked. Is that you ringing?
No, I'm going to turn it off. I forgot something. It's your grandfather.
Oh, man. Well, he and I would talk all the time about what I wanted to do when I grew up. And he'd always give me the assignment at night to go out and get the dinner. And I'd go in the chicken roost, and he'd watch me run around, and he'd go get the chicken. Would you shut that? you just can't stand for me to have a fork, can you?
No, here we go. Hollywood, here, I'll turn it off.
Come on, let's go.
So he just couldn't stand. He'd watch me go out and he'd say, go get tonight's dinner, and I'd go out and I'd catch the chicken. And then, you know, I don't know how many guys have gone out and tried to catch a chicken before, but it ain't easy. So I'd go out and catch the chicken, and he'd finally let me one day. He'd show me how to kill it, and he'd just wring his neck, and then I'd pluck the chicken and get it ready for dinner. And one night he said, why don't you, I know you like to play sports, why don't you go play football? And I said, well, I don't know, you know, if I'm ever going to be able to play football. I'm not big enough, you know, I don't think I'm big enough and strong enough. So I had that self-esteem problem really early on. And he said, you know, I tell you what, you know, being in Oklahoma, and you got to come to Oklahoma when you get a chance to, you know, get old enough to get a chance to go play there. That's kind of when it started in my mind. I said, I always want to be there because that's what my granddaddy wanted me to do. And he always said, if you ever make it big, I want you to buy me a titty pink Cadillac. And I had never seen a titty pink Cadillac before. But I was determined.
Well, you and Billy got something else in him.
So I wanted to make my granddaddy happy, and I was gonna make it, and I was gonna be, you know, a football player. And if it killed me, and my father pushed me as hard as I could, and I got through high school, and I was on a bad team, and I had a bad head coach, and he was just telling me I wasn't good enough, and I started getting recruited, and one day I'm sitting in my high school cafeteria, and I had gone to Texas A&M. The week before, and I'd been recruited by Jackie Sherrill, and I thought, this is it. I'm going to Texas A&M. Jackie Sherrill, he's, you know, he's telling me I'm going to come down there and start for the Aggies. And so I don't think I'm going to get, you know, I scheduled a trip to go to Oklahoma, but I just didn't feel that I belonged, you know, that I was worthy of going to Oklahoma. I just thought there's just too much, and, you know, the too much legend and too much history. And I said, I don't see me planting my seed up there. And Coach Switzer, I guess, found out the very next day that I'd committed to Texas A&M, and I'm sitting in my high school cafeteria, and there's 3,000 kids in my school, so there's 1,000 of us, and, you know, in the cafeteria, and I'm looking across, and I see this cat walk in a full-length mink coat. It can't be, because all the other coaches would come, and they'd pull me out of class and take me in. Here he comes, and he calls me out. Hey, where's Boss? Where's Boss? And I go, oh, no, no, no. And he's got the rings on. I know you want one of these. I know you want one of these.
You don't get it at A&M.
So he convinced me to come up, and I sat down in his office, and I said, Coach, why are you recruiting me? I mean, you got so many great players here, and you have so many, you know, players that are already on, you know, scholarship. I don't think I'm going to play here. And he looked at me and he said, I don't want you to ever think, don't you ever doubt yourself. If I'm taking the time, and, you know, I'm not a guy that wastes my time. I believe in you, and you're going to make it. I want you here on my football team. I want you part of our family. And when he said the word family, I knew that was where I was going to be. And I walked through the stadium, and I walked through the locker room, and I could feel the ghosts of the Sooners past, and I can see the ghosts of the Sooners past. And I felt like, for the first time, I was back home. And I wanted to be part of at least Oklahoma football. Now, whether or not I was going to have an impact, I had no idea. He had an idea, and he believed in me, and he was such a great coach in evaluating talent, and he's a great motivator in tapping that talent at just the right time. And he sat me down. He redshirted me my first year, and I was lost, and I didn't know what was going on, and he gave me 44 when we came in. And Lydell Carr was coming in, and he was a big recruit out of Oklahoma, and they really wanted him. And I think Lydell was 44, and they wanted Lydell bad. And it was during the recruiting trip, and he came up to me and he said, "Boz, we'd like to give your number to Lydell Carr." You know, and I don't know. I think that's when my nuts dropped. Because I said, Coach, you ain't giving my number away. That's the number you gave me, and that's the number I'm going to wear here at the University of Oklahoma. And then that spring, he actually it was in Hawaii. He came up to me. We were in a table, just going out, and he goes, you know, these guys out here, they're not motivated. They're worthless. They don't want to win. And I've redshirted all my future classmen that are going to establish Oklahoma again. And I need a leader. And he looked at me and says, Boz, I want you to be that leader. Now, whether or not you told that story to everybody else, I don't know.
But no, you were the one, you were designated.
I know the one you did. Yeah, I know the one you did, because he told me the same story about the Heisman Trophy. I was going to win a Heisman Trophy, and I almost got close enough to win a Heisman
just
Trophy.
Just one? That's all you know, just one?
Just one. But, you know, what it was for me, it was living a dream and being part of a program and a family that when I came home, I felt that family embraced me. And I think, and I've never talked about it before, but I think I've shamed the program in a lot of ways. And I want to apologize to each and every one of you guys for the things I did.
All right, Bob. Last
part of my career,
man.
Hey, we all do things.
Yes, sir.
You know, you've always been a part of the family, Brian, and always will be, and that's just part of being an actor. That's where you are today. We knew what you were. I knew what your heart was and what kind of person you were. Showman, you were on stage, and you did it for the media and attention. That's fine, but don't worry about that.
But we know what the reasons why. The contribution you made is a lot bigger than any embarrassment
you ever took. That's what I've always said to people. I said, you know, Boz was a good person. He was a great football player. He was a 3.5 student. He graduated in 3.5 years. And I said, hey, the media liked it because he danced to their tune. But I'm going to say, he never caused a problem. He was never a discipline problem. He was never involved in drugs. He was never arrested. Never did one thing that detracted from the University of Oklahoma other than promoting himself. And ain't nothing wrong with that. And I'm going to tell you a story. Deion Sanders told me at the Cowboys. He says, some white linebacker at Oklahoma can get that kind of damn attention, this damn cornerback from Florida State can do the same thing. And that was when prime time was born. He says Bosworth brought about prime time. Motivate. I swear to God, he told me that story. That's a true story. Bos said, prime time, said Deion, says, when that linebacker, white linebacker at Oklahoma can get that kind of publicity, said, I know prime time can get him some, too. And that's all an actor.
Boz, I'm going to ask you one question. Does burnt orange still make you puke?
You know, it's funny that the reason that whole thing came
you
up.
You apologize to Texas.
No, I'm not going to apologize to Texas. I'm not going to happen.
There's a bunch of us joining, buddy.
The reason that whole thing came, and I think that was where the Boz thing was born, and I think it was because this man allowed me to be me, and I think he realized that the only way that my nuts were going to drop on the football field is if I felt comfortable enough for the confidence to come out. And he just believed in me. And he just said, whatever you do, I don't care what you do, as long as it's not illegal, you're not going to get caught. You show up on Saturday, you bust your ass, you give everything you got to the University of Oklahoma, you can do whatever you want to do, and I'll support you in every way you can. But when the Texas thing started and that whole thing, that was really my girlfriend's fault, because she decided she wanted to dump me the day before my first game. We're playing for Stanford. I'm scared to death. I don't know what I'm going to do. And she dumps me the day before the game, and I'm going, what are you doing? Why are you doing this to me now? And she goes, well, I'm going to date this guy from University of Texas. I'm going, what? What the hell?
They got puked, too.
I thought it was a joke, because I thought I was, you know, the cat's meow. I was, you know, on the Oklahoma football team, and you know, I understood that, you know, I didn't take her out, and my two favorite things were Domino's pizzas and the Three Stooges at night. So I understood that. I'll get better. But she didn't buy that. But the thing that really pissed me off is she asked me, after she told me she was going to date this guy from University of Texas, can you get me Oklahoma, Texas tickets? And that was, that was the game. It was number one versus number two. We played, you know, in that rainstorm, and I was meaner and madder. I just wanted to kill every hoof that had orange on. And I happened to walk in the locker room, and the first, you know, reporter after that, she landed that bomb on me. She says, how do you feel about University of Texas? So my true feelings came out at that particular time.
What about the acronym? What about the acronym for NCAA? That's what I want to know. What about the NCAA acronym?
That's the NCAA, again, I got to, you know, give credit where credit is due. And, they were screwing with me all year long. And remember, I was spatting my shoes. I didn't have silver shoes back then because I used to just spat my shoes and write little names and you know, anecdotes and stuff on it. So that was the first time I did it. I put Fred on one side, Anchors upside down on the other. And I guess NCAA didn't like that too much. And I was just having fun. I was just, you know, you guys were having fun. We were having, you know why we had fun? Because we loved each other.
That's right.
You know what? That's when a team looks out for each other and they love each other, genuinely love each other. They don't have to be the most talented team in the world, but you're going to get the most out of them. You know, every single player, you can look down next to you and he might not be the best player in the world, but you know damn well you're going to get 110% out of him, and that 110% along with your 110% is enough to beat anybody on the football field, you know, because you believe in what you're doing and there's chemistry, and that's where magic comes from. But when we were screwing around with the shoes and I was getting a little bit out of control and the hair and all the other stuff was going on, and I got caught up in it, and Coach Switzer was having fun. And when you're winning, the climate of winning creates, you know, this crazy atmosphere. And we were in Colorado and they came up to me, or might have been you came up to me before the game and said, "Boz, they're going to kick you out of the game if you write anything on your shoes." And I'd already written it on the shoes, and we were going out just like, you know, 30 seconds before the game time. So I'm over scribbling black marker all over my shoes. And we invented, I guess I invented the black shoe then. Because then they went to black shoes. And I think they stopped the game a couple of plays in, and then, you know, you're over there going, "That's my, he doesn't have anything on his shoes. He's fine. He's playing. Let's go. Let's play this game." And we're in Boulder, Colorado. You know, and we're kicking their ass, and I remember one play, and again, I was getting all mad because I'm thinking everybody's taking, you know, a shot at me, and it was my own fault because I was putting a big bullseye on my chest. And I remember, I think they were running the wishbone, and they were just about to come into their own, and I ran around the corner, and I made a play out there on the sideline, and I came around to the student section, and I saw them up there, and I just gave them one of these, you know. And some idiot in the stands threw a frozen Coke bottle and hit that cheerleader in the head, and they had to stop the game. And I said, "Oh my God, my actions are now affecting the game, you know, and I needed to get control of it." Game was over with 28-0. Coach switches over on the sideline, and I'm standing over there next to him, and he goes, "Hell, Boz, don't stand next to me. They'll throw something at me." Down the other end. I said, "Well, Coach, I just want to come over and congratulate you on beating Colorado. They said that we're gonna this tide's a change. Colorado's gonna take control of the Big Eight." And he goes, "You know what? I just like, you know, just coming in here and kicking ass and putting a big goose egg up on the board. And, you know, let's forget about the shit with the shoes. Don't, you know, leave the shoes shit alone. And freaking them old people up in Kansas City, just a bunch of communists anyway." Okay. But you did warn me. You did warn me about wearing a shirt before, and I shouldn't have worn it. But, you know, we were up 28-0 against Arkansas, and, you know, I was, you know, feeling happy, and, you know, I made the mistake. I took the shirt off, and that was really where I think, you know, I shamed the program. And, you know, I went out on an island by myself, and I felt like at that point in time I was so out of control that I was bigger than the program, and in fact, the program was responsible for making me a man. Yeah, and I thank
good.
You.
Thank you, Brian. Let me add to something what he's saying right here, and I want everybody. Jim Riley, I got a story I want to tell about you, and the rest of the guy. Big Jim's been sitting in the back quiet. This happened. Keith Jackson calls me a year ago. I'm out in Hollywood. I mean, I was doing something out there in L.A., and I go by Boz. I call Boz, and we're going to go up and see the Dallas Cowboys work out at Oxnard. Mm-hmm. And Boz sets up a limo, and I go by, and he's building a new, beautiful home there in Malibu overlooking the ocean. And we drive up to some restaurant, and we stopped. And about that time, the phone rings, and we're having lunch and overlooking the ocean. We're going to drive up to Oxnard, you know, beautiful day out there in sunny California, Spence. And the phone rings, and I pick it up. It's Keith Jackson. Keith Jackson and I are talking about the Waldorf Astoria and the National Coaching National Hall of Fame banquet being December, and the Washington, I mean, New York, and that we were talking about the arrangements, and Keith and I were both fortunate to be able to go in together, and we were talking about that. And Boz is sitting there hearing all this conversation. And Boz, and I finally let Boz and Keith talk a minute, and then I hang up, and all of a sudden Boz says to me, "You think they'll ever let me in that damn Hall of Fame?" You on the scope. I looked at Boz.
I
said, "Boz, as long as they've kept me out of that damn thing," I said, "and you wearing that t-shirt at that Orange Bowl," I says, "they got a, my memory like an elephant." I said, "I think you have to wait a hell of a long time." I don't think it has to be as long as you.
I know there's something wrong, and I think you're probably the greatest tight end that's probably played in college football.
Offensive player of the century. Oklahoma. Just in case you didn't know.
He was a tight end on a wishbone football team. We were the number one defense statistically 27. Ever.
27.5 yards per catch. Only made big plays in big games, that's all. But then, you know, you just throw that stuff aside. Just throw that aside.
Now you know how Pete Rose feels.
Hey, Big Jim Riley sitting back there. Big Jim, did you get a chance to talk to Don Shula? Were you in town for the game yesterday or just flying today?
Don Shula and I don't talk.
Oh, you don't? Well, you played for him.
We hadn't talked in years.
You played for him?
I was a lineman.
Oh, yeah, you didn't talk to him.
Coach Shula never talked to linemen. In fact, 25-year reunion, which was 5 years ago at our 72 undefeated season, 25 years, that's how old it was, and Coach Shula comes up to a bunch of us linemen. We're all standing over and they're having a press conference because none of them wants to talk to us. So we're talking to each other. He comes over and tells a joke, and he never did tell jokes. His joke was real bad. None of us laughed. Manny Fernandez, who was my roommate for five of my 6 years with the Dolphins, says, "You know, Coach, actually, we're the ones that made you famous. You hadn't done a whole lot since we left." He said, "I just wanted you to know that." Shula walks off shaking his hand, said, "These guys will never change." And we thought that was funny. I want to say something to you, Brian. I'm proud to be sitting in this group with you sitting here with us today. I really am. Son, you... One thing you forgot about what you were, all that stuff you said you were doing, you were just a kid, number one. That's all you were. But I tell you what, just in the few minutes that you talked a while ago, man, that's pretty strong stuff. And I think you have a lot of what I try to instill in all my guys that I work with. It's called integrity. God bless you, Brian Bosworth.
I got another. I'm going to take you back to another day where you don't frequent anymore. There was one night we were at Opie's and you were sitting up at the bar years ago, and I'll never forget this. It was during spring practice, and all the guys are back in town. Warmack, you were there, and you know everybody. We were just sitting because it was spring practice, and it was a red-white game, and all the guys are back in town from different eras, and you were back, and I'll never forget this all my days. Dolan Moore had just come back from Las Vegas winning an arm wrestling championship out in Las Vegas when they had the NFL pro wrestling arm. Remember this?
Yes.
Remember, and Dolan Moore had won the NFL arm wrestling championship. And old Big Jim Riley's sitting up at the bar having a beer, and he's sitting there watching a pool game over there, and I happened to come in to see all the ex-players. We're all visiting. And there's old Ricky Bryan. He's a sophomore out of Coed, and he's wanting to, you know, test old, well, you know, get old Dolan Moore up there and see if he can handle him. And they're all, Dolan's talking about how he did it and all this, and he's coaching them up on how you do this. And Big Jim sitting there looking, and he said, "Look at that over there, a bunch of kids." And I says, Mike Riley was standing there, big bad Mike Riley. Mike Riley says, "You really think you can whip him arm wrestling?" And Jim looked at me and says, "Just like that." And so I, as the instigator, walked over and said, "Darling, you remember old man Jim Riley sitting over here, old gray-headed guy at the bar? He says, you can't put him down." He said, "Bring him over here." Oh, they scattered the tables, moved it out, got everybody away. They walked over there, and they put his hand up. Someone put his hand on top, and he moved it, and Jim Riley went, boom! Got up, walked away. Darling, wait a minute, let's do that again. Remember? He said, left-handed or right-handed? He said, no, right-handed. Put it up there again. He took his off, and Jim, this time, just looked at him, then went, boom. True story?
Yes, sir.
Went back over and finished his beer. Oh, I tell you what, all those young football players, Ricky Bryan, all turned, looked at Jim. Who is he? Where does he play?
Hey, this is the
story you were telling the guys earlier today before we started this taping about an airplane ride. You had them in stitches. You sound like you had yourself a whole little...
I was 1974. Yeah. I'm going to speak at Hooks High School Banquet, and you can understand why I'm going to go speak at this all-sports banquet in Hooks, Texas. And I go out to the airmen at Westheimer and Norman, and I think that I ought to take our great running back, Greg Pruitt, with me down there to let all the people in Hooks, Texas see Greg Pruitt, and I get our... running back coach Wendell Moseley on the plane, I can't remember who else was with us. It was Wendell, me.
No,
you.
I think it was coach that was Dale Gabe.
Bill Shimmick, who is had the Billy's area for recruiting for his assistant coach for us. So
no, we all here on the plane. He just had me. No,
he lived in Hooks.
77 straight days.
77 straight. Well, anyway, we get on this airplane. And we leave Norman, and we haven't been gone 3 or 4 minutes, and I want Greg to take over now. You tell what.
Oh, I had pulled a prank earlier on Shimmick, and I knew he was going to get me back. I just didn't know when. So I'm sitting on this plane, and I look out the window, and I see the propeller slow down. Me, I'm saying, I ain't going for that. They trying to get me. So I looked at the engine, and smoke started coming out. So I didn't think they had that kind of control. So I looked back inside. I said, hey, this engine is stopped. And I looked at the Coach Moseley. Coach Moseley is sitting up with the pilot, and he's just going through all these books. He's throwing books around. I said, Coach, what are you doing? He said, I'm trying to learn how to land this on one engine. Which kind of broke the ice, because we were getting nervous, but the pilot, he stayed pretty cool, and we landed. And I really didn't get scared till after we landed. And then I realized that it was not a whole lot of pilots that could land a plane on one engine. He happened to be one of them. So
this is what happens. We land that plane, and I asked him, who's going with me on this next plane to Hooks, Texas? I went by myself.
We've got more stories. Greg Pruitt.
I can tell you a story that because of Joe Washington, we missed the bus.
What game was that, Joe?
That was Kansas State.
Kansas State. And Joe was a freshman.
And I was rooming with Greg in that.
He was my roommate.
He's throwing you under the bus here. Yeah, is what's happening.
So we got up that morning, and we had a little routine. Joe liked to watch Kid Power. And so I
could tell by that time what time we needed to leave.
It was okay because I too knew about after it was over, it was time to go catch the bus. Well, the time was set back that night, and we failed to remember that. So when Kid Power came on, it came on like an hour later. And so Joe knew it, but I hadn't realized that him being a freshman, I didn't want to listen to what a freshman couldn't tell me anything. So he kept saying, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go. I said, come on, you get nervous, it's the game. They're not going to leave Joe Washington and Greg Pruitt.
Somebody's going to leave Greg Pruitt. They will leave Joe Washington. I'm a freshman.
So anyway, we go out to the bus. There's an empty bus sitting out there. And I said, here I am. I'm listening to this freshman. And I'm out here first. I don't like to be first. I like to be last.
So I get on in Chuck's seat.
I'll let you take over.
No, we get out there. Three buses like we always have. And Greg gets on the bus, and he sits in the front seat, Chuck's seat, and he sits up here with his hands like this. I'm saying, well, I told you, we early. I go to the back, just like a little freshman does, and we sit there for about 5 or 10 minutes, and then Greg looks back there at me, and he says, they left us.
Can you believe they left us? So we called a highway patrol, and they laughed. After they got through laughing, they sent a car, and we actually beat the bus to Norman. So we're getting dressed. So I know we're in big trouble. And I know Chuck, as soon as he know we're there and he gets there, he's going to have something to say. So I'm telling Joe, let me do all the talking. Don't say nothing. And sure enough, they come and get us, and he calls us a lot of different names. And Joe starts laughing, and I start laughing. Chuck wasn't laughing. I think we didn't start that game, did we?
No, I know
I think
I didn't.
We didn't start that game. I think we ended up playing like the second quarter, but we won. But that was Joe's fault.
Yeah. but the killing part is he called me a jackass freshman. He called Greg a horseshit Heisman Trophy candidate. and then he called him a prima donna, and Greg said, "Thank you, coach."
And Greg always killing
it. Sounds good.
Yeah. He said he didn't realize a couple of years later what the man had said. I didn't know what he said either. So.
Prima donna. Hey. That wasn't the only time you missed the bus.
I thought about the Sugar Bowl when
they were just. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking about. I'm talking about the Sugar Bowl.
This is a true story. I got this rep for being late, even though I tried to be on time. So I was, in fact, going to the Sugar Bowl. We got the wrong itinerary, myself and Ken Pope. And we drove to New Orleans. It was his car. I was riding. I wasn't driving. But when we got there, we were late, like an hour late. So he told us, anything happen the rest of the week, you're going to be in big trouble. So it's the day of the game. So I said, you know, this is my last game as a senior. I said, I'm going to surprise everybody. I'm going to be on time. So I get dressed, and I go down to the elevator. I'm like 45 minutes before I should be there. And this elevator never stopped on that floor. So I'm standing there. My roommate comes out. He said, man, you still waiting on this elevator? I said, yeah. He said, well, just take the service elevator. I said, no, I'm not taking the service elevator. I'm waiting on this elevator. So as a result, it never did come. So eventually, I took the elevator. I missed the bus again. So I go in. And, you know, like, you know how the locker room is like a bar. I mean, it's loud. And when I hit the door, it's like you can hear a pin drop. I said, oops, I'm in trouble again. So I go to my locker, just try to pretend ain't nothing happening. I don't have any. I don't have no uniform. I don't have nothing. They say, all right, you got the Coach Fabry want to see you. So I go in, and he has my uniform next to him, and then he just goes off on me. Just go, and that's when he called me the prima donna. That's what I told him. I said, oh, thank you, Coach. And he really went off then. So I didn't start that game either. We played I think we played Penn State, right?
Yeah, Penn State.
Played Penn State.
Yeah, I don't know. You probably know this, but Switzer and Galen Howard are begging Chuck said, oh, he got to play. He's got to play, Coach.
I think he learned his lesson. Pretty good. Don't let him play at first series. When we're on defense.
Doing the show the other day with the Alabama heroes, we started laughing about Alabama having a curfew coach. Ken Stabler was sitting right up there where Keith is sitting today. Did you have to do a lot of that, a lot of policing when you were the head coach?
Well, I had a lot of police around. I didn't That's a low blow here. Yeah, you threw me under the bus. Hey, I remember 1984 in the Orange Bowl, we got beat by Washington. And the next year, you weren't going to let that happen again. Remember, we had 2-a-days in the Orange Bowl in 1985?
Made us leave 2 weeks early. That's
2 weeks right. Early. Brought these mats underneath the bleachers.
Wouldn't let us go to any of the events, couldn't have any fun, couldn't drink, couldn't do nothing.
It wasn't any fun.
We won a national championship.
That's right.
I'd rather have that ring than be out.
I love you for that, too. Yeah. Thank you. Appreciate you coming to Oklahoma, too.
I think it was me and my roommate came in late, and the elevator opened up, and there's Coach Switzer sitting there, and it's past curfew. And he looks at us, and he goes, oh, hell, I'm just now getting in, too.
You're lucky you weren't a turd. Hey, did we treat them different? No, we never did. Hell, we don't.
Hey, Coach Swisher.
Oh, that was the halftime I walked into. This, y'all probably heard the story, some of you. You know, recruiting is the key. You know, acquiring a talent is the key. And I've always thinking about the difference, make an edge in someone. Why? The true story, I went behind a kid's house one night because I want to know what the daddy drank, because I knew the damn daddy's going to offer me a beer. So when he offered me the beer, I said, only if it's a pearl. The daddy looked at me and said, you drink pearl? I said, yeah. I said, I'd take it across the Red River, but a case is where I go back to the water. So you got to have an edge in recruiting. Now, I'm serious. I did that. I wanted to know what kind of beer he drank, because he going to ask me when I went in that house. But I go into the locker room. Joe's putting a half a hundred on him. I mean, about 100, but he's probably putting nearly 200 yards rushing on a Colorado up at Boulder that day. So I'm going in. Ain't nothing to talk to the team about. And there's got a payphone. Eddie, the locker room had a payphone on the wall.
Well, yeah, you didn't think we were going to let you off for nothing.
Yeah, but he had a payphone over there. But yeah, I think I ain't got nothing to do. Had Bobby Bell give me a quarter, dime, whatever it took him back. I dropped it in there and I called CJ's Conoco Service Station, Hooks, Texas, on I-30 coming out of Texarkana. And the guy, CJ, answers the phone. CJ, is Billy there? Yeah, he's outside pumping gas right now. So let me talk to him. He comes inside. Says, hey, Billy, it's Coach. He said, Coach, you're supposed to be at the game. I said, hell, I am at the game. It's halftime. Aren't you listening to it? He said, yeah, I'm listening to it on the radio right now. He said, I'm out there pumping gas. I said, I want you to call you, let you know. He says, hey, he says, I want you playing for me next year. I want you to be the guy carrying the ball like little Joe doing it. We talked for 20 minutes, half. The official comes back, taps me on the shoulder, and he says, Coach, time to get your team back out in the team. You got 5 minutes. I said, hear that, Billy? He said, I got to finish his ass kick, and I'll call you back. I said, I know Billy Sims knows I can't call anybody else, Bo. You know what I mean? That time frame, you know, when you do a coaches at night, you pick a phone. I just thinking about you and how important you are to our program, you know. Billy knew I had a choice to make. I can call one person, and I called him. So it makes a little edge in recruiting.
Oh, blew me away.
But, you know,
blew me away.
I mean, the story I like to tell.
Blew me away. And the fact I come up to visit that weekend, little Joe, of course, they're going to put the ace guy on me, show me around everything, and finally get a chance to meet Coach Swisher's family and everybody. So I goes to his house, and this little kids, I mean, they was little rocks then. He said, Sims, guess what? I said, what, Coach? They want you here so bad, they already selling your jersey with the name on them. All his kids had number 20 on
them. And Sims on the back of the jersey. I said, come, this is the pump place.
I believe it.
Billy,
I went back to Hooks, Texas, man. I told the whole town they're selling my jersey. I'm signing.
Did you tell Jack Bear to put that on there for me?
No, I hadn't made up. All my kids come running out the car when Billy came to the house. They didn't know anything about it, but they were about this. Yeah, Kathy with the big, thick glasses, yeah, and Greg
glasses,
and Coke
bottle
glasses.
But
they had 20 and Sims on. But, to me, what's special is y'all, players. And the relationship you had, players, all the wins and championships, bowl victories, all those things are great, you know, but it's the relationships, and that's the only thing that really matters in life is the family and relationships you have and the love you have for one another. Right. And things that make important, you talk about what games are important, these plays and all, it's things that in your tenure, in your career, it is relationships and moments that you have that are special between you and that player. Now, like I've had it between little Joe, because we all know Joe was a superstar and what kind of player he was. And Joe's senior year and last game playing at Norman, Oklahoma, I did what I thought was right, and I had Joe come off the field with the 30 seconds to go in the game, because I knew 75,000 people were going to stand and applaud. Well, for a week after that, Joe was walking around pouting like a damn baby and wouldn't hardly speak to me. And I bothered him. I said, what's going on? Joe rushed in his career for 3,995 yards. He missed 4,000 yards by 5 yards. And I took him out of the game for the right reason, but I didn't leave him in there to get a goal that he didn't communicate to me that allowed him to do something he wanted to do. Lack of communication. Mm-hmm. And I've always regretted it. I thought about, I'm doing the right thing, but Joe was upset about that.
Well, still are, Joe.
But no. Hey, but you know, the other is one day. Hey, of course, we get Billy come to Oklahoma, and we know what a great player Billy was. And we go that last season, in 1979, you know, Herschel Walker came out early. Remember, his first guy to come out to go to the NFL, started the vogue for players to come out early. So what happens is Billy comes in my office, Brian, in 1978, wins the Heisman Trophy. I know he's got an agent because those kids and good players that got agents don't ever come to me anymore for help. You know what I mean? Thank God. You know what I mean, Eddie? I know they got an agent because they ain't coming to me for help. So Billy comes in my office and says, Coach, I'm thinking about coming out. I'm going to go pro. And, you know, I've been here 4 years and won the Heisman. And says, you're old as hell. You're afraid you're going to get too old for the NFL. So what happens? I said, Billy, I said, you promised Miss Sadie you're going to get a degree and all that. So I'm doing the best I can. Hey, I'm pumping away. And I said, really, bottom line, says, what do you and Brenda need? And he said, well, I got some bills out there. I said, how much are they? He said, about $1,500. I think I can handle that. And so I said, you come back tomorrow, we'll get that handled. So I got that handled the next day. And well, that next year, we're going down trying to win the national championship again. And we lost to Texas in a close game, and we're undefeated the rest of the way. And we got to play Nebraska, ranked 2 or 3 in the country. And the week before, we got a tough game on national television. Billy rushes for 280-something yards up at Missouri, and we got to go back on national television in Norman. And Nebraska is undefeated, 10-0, leading the nation, the black shirts, in 68 yards a game rushing. I mean, you know, they always did. They ain't the same black shirts of old today, you know what I mean? But they were then. They were a great defensive football team. Well, they only given up 68 yards, and it's Thursday afternoon. We're doing a kicking game, and I walk over to Billy, and I sit down beside him. We're just sitting there talking about his career and what he accomplished. Miss Sadie going to get his degree. You stayed. You won the Heisman. You're probably not going to get it. Charlie White's probably, they're going to probably give it to Charlie. He's leading, getting a little more yards than you, but you had a great week on national television last week, and you got one more left in you. You know what Billy did? He turned to me and said, Coach, I saved the best for last. I got one more in me. I said, really? You know, kind of excited me. What he said, yeah. He says, watch me Saturday. That's a true story, what you told me, right? First play of the game, we gave the ball off the fullback. We always do, try to see how people play the corner and perimeter, you know, for the option play. We ran to something else, and it's 3rd down and 3. And we hand the ball to Billy. He goes 73 yards the first time he touches it. Touchdown. They call it back. We clipped on the play. Freddie Nixon. Well, we take it on in, get the field goal and all. Well, let me tell you this. I'll hurry it up and finish it up. With 2 minutes, with 1 minute to go in the game on the PA system, they announce, and we're leading. We got the ball down. We got the score down. We just scored, went ahead. J.C. Watt scored. We're leading by 3-4 points, and we're running out the clock. And the PA system, they announce on the PA system, Billy Sims has now rushed for 247 yards. The most yards ever rushed on a Nebraska team. Today, the most yards ever rushed on a Nebraska team. He had one left in. And I think about that. I mean, think about the moment that he said that and then go out and do that and beat their ass and had a 73-yard run call back. You know, that's pretty stout, pretty strong. That's the things I think about.
Well, that had to do with you know, I'm going to cut it short. My first pick was really Baylor University. Believe it or not, I went to Texas or Arkansas. Remember one time when you came to my game, Frank Ball, Durrell, y'all was all in that little box at Hooks.
It wasn't wide as this.
It wasn't wide as this. And I sneak out the door because I didn't want to see any coaches and go eat my ritual chicken fried steak dinner after the Friday night game. So I had to go back that Saturday and clean up the stadium. I did that. I really did. But one guy snooted me out. The old hound dog over there. Couldn't get away from him. But he told me, he said, yeah, you can go to Baylor. But we're going to kick your ass every Saturday when we play you. That's all that's going to be there, you and Baylor. And I saw the whole picture then. When you're surrounded by great players and great athletes, it really make your job a lot easier. I learned that when I went to Detroit, by the way. But I appreciate Coach not just for giving me the opportunity to come here, but at one time I almost left over you. He probably don't, Coach know that.
I think about quitting.
Most of you do. Casillas, I had to go get him, too. How many of you didn't have to go get?
And I wasn't going nowhere, Coach.
We won't go into that. But I was.
And, you know, as a youngster, you know, you high recruit and everything, you stay hurt, and you can tell a lot of the coaches don't want to talk to you and won't be around you, you know, but Coach Switzer stayed in my corner and believed in me, and the rest is history, and I love you for that, Coach.
I love you, too. Really do. I love all of you.
Yeah,
you
know, I know that.
Thing about it, you know, you come
in there. It's not about, because all the schools I visit, only one ever talk about family, and that was Oklahoma.
That's what we're talking about. Spencer was talking about, you know, when he was talking about John Blake, is that, you know, when you go away, and especially, you know, you come in a room like this with all the great players that have been a part of this program, you know, it's kind of hard to get that fraternity and kind of the niche and as you go on in your, you know, life after football and everything, you know, and you're able to come back and, you know, it's like you sit there and tell stories and, you know, only, you know, players that can relate to. And even in pro football, I mean, you don't have the family that you do in college, especially the University of Oklahoma. And it's guys like Coach Switzer and, you know, Steve Davis, Merv Johnson. You know, Merv recruited me. And, I mean, he was, you know, I saw him more than I saw my teachers at school. You know, he was there all the time. He's a great guy. But that's the thing about it, all this room is you come in here and it's just like you go back to when this goes back in time, you start talking about the stories and the University of Oklahoma is just the place that I'm glad that Pete, the players can do that and be in a room where that's all you talk about is the times that you remember when the battles, because, you know, it's hard to replace that in real life as far as what you accomplish on the field.
I like the shared experiences. You know, there was times when we'd be in our dorm room and, you know, I grew up in North Tulsa, man. We were broke as the Ten Commandments. We didn't have anything coming up. But we, if somebody came by a dorm room or something, you know, we had those couches that kind of sit low. And every once in a while, my roommate at the time was Roy Owens, who was from Booker T. Washington, Tulsa. And we were hungry. We didn't have any money, you know. So Roy, he was upset at something. He was looking for something. He pulled up the top of the cushion on the couch. Saw a lot of money in there. So he said, well, I wonder how that's happening. So Roy said, well, when you sit down, if you sit down at the right angle, all the money, if you got coins in your pocket, it just falls out. He said, well, we're going to have everybody send this. When they come up here, and at the end of the month, we're going to find us some pizza and Krusty's. We're going to go something to eat.
Sit on that couch.
Sit on that couch right over there.
I tell you the greatest moment, and I think the only moment I ever wanted to cry on a football field, and all of you played together with a group of players for so long. The year we graduated, it was about 15 seniors that graduated the year I came out. I remember about 14 of them went in the draft, and four of them were second teamers. We were pretty talented back in those days. But that walk as seniors holding hands that last time on the field for that last home day game is just something that really stays in my mind as being special. It wasn't the victories. It wasn't even the defeats. And, you know, I go back to the Kansas game we lost up there when Danny Bradley got hurt. But it wasn't that. But that, I mean, that really, I mean, walking out there, I had to kind of fight back those tears going, this is going to be my last time playing with Ricky Ditson and Bosworth and Troy Johnson and Darrell Reed and all those guys just in the line. And I knew that was something special about it. But as I reflect now sitting here with all these guys, I know that everybody in that room been through that. Everybody in this room has been through that. That last walk, this will be the last time that I hold hand with some of these guys. I'm fortunate enough to play with some guys, maybe in the NFL, but this will be the last time. It won't be anything this special ever again, you know. And it's better than high school, you know. And it really.
Fortunately, those kind of memories can live on through gatherings such as this. We're going to wrap things up. This has been a very quick 4.5 hours, but we appreciate everybody being here today and letting me kind of eavesdrop and learn about your proud program and. All the best, and I know the fans at OU are going to enjoy this for years to come. Thank you, gentlemen.
Hey, before we leave, I think we should all come together in the middle of this floor. Do one Boomer, one Sooner. All right? We're a family. We came in as a family. We're going to leave as a family.
All right,
family.
Come on, raise up there. Here we go. Here we go. All right, take the mics off. Take those mics off. Hell, we electrocute ourselves here. That's hell the way it ended today, wouldn't it be?
All right, here we go.
And on that Boomer Sooner, it's history. I'm Larry Black, executive.